For many readers, Thrór's map would be their first introduction to the maps found throughout Tolkien's books, the first of many. Some study these more than the text itself, and others glance and move on with the rest of the story. I wanted to make this video to talk briefly about this special map, showing some different versions, and how it is possibly an example of outside influences changing Tolkien's Legendarium itself. Much of what I am sharing here is found in The Art of the Hobbit by legendary scholars Christina Skull and Wayne G. Hammond. I highly recommend this book. For extra detail about this map, its versions, and other images related to The Hobbit. In The Hobbit, Thrór's map was said to be a map given to Gandalf the Wizard by the dwarf Thrain the Second, before he died as a prisoner in Sauron's stronghold of Dol Guldur in Mirkwood, the Hill of Sorcery. Sauron, the necromancer at this time, had tortured the dwarf to take one of the Rings of Power from him. Gandalf, not knowing who he was, found him and was given a key and a map. The map was a plan of the Lonely Mountain, Erebor, a home of the dwarves that had been empty since the dragon Smaug drove out the dwarves, declaring the kingdom and its riches as his. Thrór's grandson, Thorin, known as Thorin Oakenshield, did not think this map to be anything special, aware of the mountain itself and the surrounding lands shown. "There is one point that you haven't noticed," said the wizard, "and that is the secret entrance. You see that rune on the west side, and the hand pointing to it from the other runes? That marks a hidden passage to the lower halls." Along with the key that went with it, the map was one of the most important items in the Third Age of Middle-earth, fundamentally important when it came to the quest of Erebor, the dwarves' journey to the Lonely Mountain to reclaim it from the dragon Smaug, undertaken by Thorin's company of dwarves, Gandalf, and of course, the hobbit Bilbo Baggins. It is the map that leads to the story of the hobbit, to Bilbo picking up a certain magic ring, and then the story of the Lord of the Rings. It is fitting that this is the first map that most readers will encounter when deciding to pick up a book and read what all the fuss is about with this author, j.r.r. Tolkien. The very first version of this map is one of only 6 pages to survive from the earliest version of The Hobbit, before Thrór even had that name. The name used at this time was Fimbul Fambi, a strange name to those of us who do not speak Icelandic, what it really means, mighty fool. This version of the map still looks familiar, but there are differences from the versions we will see in our copies of The Hobbit. The annotated Hobbit says that the symbols used as the compass points are the constellation Ursa Major, or the plough, north, which in the Legendarium is known as Valakirka, the sickle of the Valar, the sun, south, and maybe Valinor to the west, and the gates of Morn to the east. Runes inscribed read Fang, the secret passage of the dwarves. One thing that is noticeable here is that the map is drawn vertically on one page, with north, east, south and west in the traditional places we know from our own maps. I'll explain later why that is significant. Tolkien makes some changes for the next version of this map. It starts to become a part of what we call the Legendarium. It no longer seems like a map drawn by the author himself, but one of the characters, with the map stating this is a copy of the original, copied by Bilbo himself. The compass point symbols are now the runes used for north, east, south and west. Tolkien's idea for this map was to have it be incorporated into the story itself, and not just the book, placing it on the page when it is mentioned, in chapter 1 or even chapter 3. It is once again a vertical one-page map, with north, east, south and west in the traditional positions. What is great about this version of the map is that Tolkien drew the moon letters, runes that could only be read when the light of the moon shone on them, on the back of the map. Just like they are revealed in the story, the reader would hold the map up to the light, and the letters would be revealed. This is immersion beyond having the map shown as a copy made by one of the characters. This idea never made it into the published version, due to financial issues with publication. This led to the map appearing as an end paper, the double page image you will see if you have a copy of The Hobbit at hand. Those runes Tolkien had drawn on the back were now on the front. That's unfortunate, but there are other improvements that happened because of this change. The rotation of the map had Tolkien place east at the top of the map, where north would be traditionally placed. The map resembling a medieval map, where this was common. Tolkien then says in an author's note before chapter 1, "On the map, the compass points are marked in runes, with east at the top, as usual in dwarf maps, and so read clockwise, east, south, west, north." Tolkien recommended other changes which were not implemented. The publisher's idea to have the runes mentioning the secret door be printed in red was not one Tolkien agreed with, but the red runes remained. He also wanted to change the text on the map from "East lie the Iron Hills, where is Dain," to "East lie the Iron Hills, where Dain dwells." If you open your copy and look at the map, you will see that change wasn't made. Tolkien doesn't say whether the changing of orientation influenced further changes made to the map, whether this publication matter made him rethink the map. East is placed at the top, and this becomes a tradition of the dwarves. This in turn leads readers to imagining why this would be the case. Such a simple change leading to people wondering if this is in mockery of elves, related to origins of dwarves, or where many of them dwell. East may be home, they look to the east, thus it is first on the map. None of those ideas have to be true, but such a simple change from one version of a map to another, possibly due to something like budget constraints, gives the dwarves yet another layer of curiosity. It adds to the mythology itself. A custom of the dwarves as shown to us on a hobbit's copy of a map originally drawn up by a dwarf. It's not just Tolkien's texts that go through many revisions, and it's not just matters related to Arda or the story that influence those revisions. Maybe we could have gotten a map revealing secrets under light, but we may have lost a glimpse into a custom of the secret of dwarves and all the speculation that comes with. It's a curious looking map, fitting for the dwarves. I hope this brief look at Thrór's map may influence those who skip the maps, who skip author's notes and details outside the story they are eager to read. Such attention to detail is worth more than a glance. There's a lot of history behind these images Tolkien wanted to place within the pages of his story. Thanks for watching this video looking at the brief history of a map. Some watching may think it's not the most exciting topic covered in the channel, but I really enjoy looking at how Tolkien's works changed over time, which is the whole point of this archive series, and I'm not one to ignore everything that isn't The Silmarillion, The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings. If you want to support my efforts with this channel, please consider subscribing, and maybe checking out my Patreon page, where you can sign up and talk with me and other supporters on Discord about Tolkien. Once again, I hope you will return for the next chapter of The Red Book.